for my collector. In order to calculate that one, we went and collected that 9 angles. 3 angles were for the surface, 6 angles were for your sub. So relating that cos theta, we calculated. And then eventually cos theta was nothing but we wanted to normalize the component from your surface of the thing which is in the same. I need to have the amount of radiation. It's not only about the amount of radiation I get, what type of radiation I'm getting. Is it because the quality also matters? If the quality is less, then I need to go for more amount of energy to meet with the need. If it is a high quality, then just 2 units of energy is sufficient to meet with the thing. So we saw about the distinction between the qualities, and then we said that one is called as a beam radiation, which is a high quality, because it's directly coming and then the diffuse radiation, and then we had a reflective radiation. So this is the kind of scenarios we left in the last class. But now that I know how to calculate and I know the quality of it, if someone sells, I know that this is the quality of it. And if the, as a colonial person, as an not a solar connected person, how can you tell today what the radiation we receive is a beam or not? He said it's a direct radiation, so high quality or not. How do you comment? I don't know solar energy. What is the best way to tell, like, this is definitely a high quality light. Given the best scenario, I'm receiving it from the sun to my place or to my collector or to myself. I'm receiving it wherever I'm standing. This is the best radiation I'm receiving. Quality, high quality radiation I'm receiving. How do you say that? No, you're going more deeper into it. Temperature I can't measure. I have to say like this. I'm going and standing in the sun. Now you see this, right? I mean, how do you guys? You have to know what you are getting. And then again I choose
my minus D.
Right? Right now I see it is bright. I say I have to some extent if the sun is seen, you can see like that. But I'm just asking, you have to walk up. What do you say? Did you get the high quality or low quality? These are the only two differences, right? High quality, low quality, high quality is your medium. I mean what is that? The low quality is it is an reflective component. Reflected also is relatively higher than your that is compared to the energy level. Reflected component is better in quality in compared to your diffuse. Because the radiation is not being done by anything. It just hits it like a ball.
ഇൻപുട്ട് ചാനൽ വന്നില്ല ലൈനിൽ കാണുന്നുണ്ട് കുഴപ്പമില്ല മൈക്ക് ക്യാമറ
മറ്റേതാണ് Mirror is what? It reflects completely about you, right? The entire radiation is limited. But if it is diffused, a mirror cannot reflect the radiation. It cannot focus the radiation if it is diffused radiation. So the best thing is your shadow. The shadow tries to tell you that, oh, if you see that the radiation, it can be reflected.
The mirror. So minimum is your shadow. You can tell, like, yes, the radiation. At the maximum, as you all know, my shadow will be by myself, otherwise I see either in the front or in the back depending on their time of the day. So that is how you are getting the quality. There is a practical value. You go and say, and if not, you see the brightness and comment about it. If it is cloudy, you still can see each other, right? If it is cloudy, we can still see. We can still see as a each other person, but still that may not be helping for certain types of collectors which we will go in. So today we are trying to see that, now that I understood everything about the radiation, how to calculate minimum to get into the quality, now I am reflecting it, how should I trap the solar energy? Okay, I have somewhere, I need a bucket of hot water. I need a bucket of hot water for me to take bath, to bath. So I'm just roughly taking you all into understand. For bathing, roughly what temperatures you will use? Of course it varies. I'll take cold water bath now. Forget about that. In your analysis also, generally you need to take some values, right? Acceptance values. For coffee or a tea, generally you like to have cold chai or hot chai? So we have a certain amount of temperature to take. Roughly what is the temperature people take back? Of course you can't tell 100 degrees Celsius a person can really take bath of that temperature. Why I'm saying this is, I wanted to tell, like, when you are assuming some data in your research analysis, everything should be quantified, everything should be reasoned out. Why not? There is a certain range in which you are picking up. Oh, I didn't have this, I picked it up. Justify it. Why it? And then you need, the justifying of yourself is different, and then you picking up the data from the references is different. For your research, you need to take the data from your references. That this is why 40 liters, this time I take 20 gallons, 20 liters of water. Or 100 liters of water for taking bath. The another one, like a crow, they can just touch upon and come. That is not the way to take the data and going and debate about it. In research, we need to go back and giving the quantifying thing. So there, if I wanted to get, I'm taking a bucket of hot water for taking bath, then I'm putting it outside. This is the way to collect the energy. I'm running fast. What do? Sun is there. Sun can heat it, right? Yes or no? A bucket of water, it can be heated. How long would it take? What's the story there? Why is it taking that long time? Though you quantified solar radiation as a high quality and low quality, I still have the problem of, for my timing, I'm not able to get it heated. I took just a bucket of water and left it there. All that is, I do nothing. Do you think that guy is going to get heated up? It may take at the end of the day. If I put it outside, have you heard about the babies being left outside in the early morning for them to get exposed to the sun? Have you heard? We don't know anything. These are all ladies' jobs. We were born and then someone else is taking care. I mean, the early morning radiation has B vitamin. Let us not get into that aspect. Even if parents come to United States, they all get the vitamin D deficiency. Because we need vitamin D in order to absorb what? Why do we need vitamin D? Do you get vitamin D in any of the vegetables or anything? But vitamin D is required for what? I'm going too much staggered now. Why I'm telling this? Get connected to a practical level. That's what I'm telling. Vitamin D comes only with your tablets or some other chemicals. They try to do it. And vitamin D is very much essential in order to absorb from the milk. If you wanted to absorb that vitamin C, you need to get the calcium. If you want to absorb, you need a vitamin D along with it. So usually they try to mix up some amount of it. So we are getting it from sun because we are having 11 degrees and 12 degrees, but cold areas and all, they need to have the vitamin D supplements. So I'm trying to take you all back in the morning hours. Yes, it has an additional component of this vitamin D rays when it is, because it is passing through a longer angle of approach. It is unfiltrated before the dust and all gets collected. You are able to get that type of energy. So that is the other reason the babies are left, because the skin is trying to absorb. Because babies are left only for milk, right? Milk has to get absorbed in the body for that absorption. This is more essential. But that is, why I am adding sometimes the practical value is you will really get connected to whatever is happening. It's not like sentimental or orthodox way people are having. Everything has scientific meaning behind what is being done around us. Don't know. That's why I always keep the rule as our previous generations are intelligent than us. Then we will be humble and humility will be there within us. Now going back to the story, guys, I took my bucket of hot water and then I need to get it hot. I need to get it faster. So I'm using my engineering skills back inside my brain. I take a bucket of hot water that's much easier to get heated than a barrel of water. Right? Same temperature. You never commented to me about the temperature. Roughly what temperature do you think you would like to stand with your temperature? Roughly, individual, at least one person. Perfect, guys, perfect. Perfect assumption, perfect approximation. That is perfectly right. Like around 45 to 50 degrees Celsius is the kind of thing. Otherwise, if it is more than that, you will get burnt also. Even TV might be slightly higher. So this is the temperature you want it to get. Whether it is one bucket of water, whether it is one barrel of water. If I'm going to throw it one bucket and then I see that the quantity increases, my heating time also is different. So I wanted to get quickly heated these. I have to come up with a methodology. What is the methodology I can get to see? So I'm looking that in terms of my thermal conductivities also, right? I mean, what has a certain capacity, right? So what has a certain amount of your specific heat, and the thermal conductivity also plays an important role. So majorly, if you wanted to distribute as a thermal conductivity, I want to choose a material which can quickly trap the energy, because although we call this the solar energy has the quality within itself, by general, solar energy is a diffused energy. Wind is a diffused energy. Coal is a concentrated energy. So from concentrated, little coal is enough. It will burn up with the fire and you can very quickly, within 5 minutes, you can heat up the water. But with the wind as well as this gas, you cannot. It is diffused. I need to concentrate it back. I need to bring them together. So I need to have a special collector. If I take a bucket of water, who said it cannot get heated? It can get heated. Only problem is the time. So in Chinese years, you know, 1,000 years, I always like to expose what has happened in the past, and you can appreciate how the technology, without even studying what is the physics laws and everything, it was existing and how people utilized. So I was able to capture one of the historical, you guys will be getting exposed to that. Don't laugh at anything. We know nothing. But if you do not know why they did it, at least I spent some of my time, I can tell like this was the mathematical or physical laws or thermodynamic laws governing that kind of action. Now going back into the story here, I need to come back with a certain type of material which can quickly get that heat, whatever the heat, now it is 20 degrees maybe, right?
Or 80 degrees to 20 degrees, so I need to tap that energy back into my thing. What can I do? So all that I have in this universe is some material called as the gaseous material, some material called as the liquid material, some material called as your solid material. In relative terms, the thermal conductivity of solids are higher compared to your liquid. We saw in the introductory class itself the units, right? It is less than 1, this one is around 10, this one is around 100 solids. In the solids also, we saw that metals are elevated. So now I'm using my engineering skills. Okay, let me take a metallic plate. Okay, in that metallic also, we have different types of metals. You have copper, you have bronze, you have iron, you have steel, right? So they're aluminum. These are common materials what you see around you. Okay, I'm using copper. Naturally, copper is expensive. But still, its thermal conductivity is around 300 to 400. And then if you take your iron, that is another common thing, or an aluminum. The copper is also lighter, but compared to copper, aluminum is lighter. So aluminum is around 200, around 200 or something like that, 100 is your alum. So, you know what is alum? The thermal conductivity, K. In your conduction equation, what is your conduction? Heat is conducted through the solid, is a conduction, right? The K value. Thermal conductivity, watts per meter square Kelvin. Do you read in English or do you read in your language? So okay, if I want you to calculate the heat transfer within a solid, this solid, how do you calculate it? Q is what? Heat transfer, right? And then, so how do you calculate within a solid body? K A dT by dx, right? Otherwise delta T by L. We can refer that language and all in later, because these are fundamentals. I know for sure you guys know what it is. If I write as afterwards, maybe you know what is delta T by the thickness.
Delta T? No?
Yeah. So you know, right? So area, what is K? Right, that's all. We are calling it as a thermal conductivity because that is what it is. It is. The conductivity can be either electrical, either thermal, it is all any conducting materials. Okay, that is a conducting constant. It is a material property respective to the material. That's what I was talking about. This K value, it is depending on the material. Solids, liquids or gases. Within the solids, what is the value you have it for your metals, in metals, what is that? Because I want to tap that heat. I want to take it my bucket of water to be heated quicker. I don't want to wait for 4 hours. So, in order to do that, I'm using my engineering skills. Instead of gas and liquid, I'm going to use a metal for it to pick up the heat. So, I put a power plate there. That time will get heated up within 5 minutes. So, in this also, I use my common sense that if I'm going to put a thicker copper, this is the same copper material, if I'm going to go for a thick block, it's going to take a longer time, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Now, if I'm going to make it to be thinner, too thinner, again, it is also a problem with the losses also. That should be the optimal value. Usually, what is that we use it is for collecting the heat for a medium temperatures, we try to have 3 millimeter. Can you imagine what is 3 millimeter from your ruler, right? That is the thinness of your copper material we are utilizing. Given that as a scenario, now, what is the thermal conductivity of the steel? I have a reason to ask for it. I said that we have the thermal conductivity of your copper as your 300 to 400, right? Watt per meter Kelvin. And then, coming back to your aluminum, which is more lighter, and in fact, in the electrical, distributions also these days, people have gone back to aluminum kind of stuff because too expensive, the copper does. Now, going back from there, we see steel as a component, right? Can we use it steel also? Why not? Steel is also a metal, and a lot, right? So what is that you would like to, can you use it? What is its thermal conductivity around?
50.
Around 50. 16 is the kind of an analog. So much different from your aluminum. We might be taken back telling that, oh, aluminum, steel might be better than aluminum. That's why I'm telling that thermal conductivity plays a bigger role to go back. Okay, now I chose copper. I went into the copper. I'm only making sense for you all because you guys are almost exposed to all these collectives and everything back into your studies. I will still take a little bit of fundamentals, but you guys are going to listen to the lecture. At the end of the game, you guys are going to do a group work. And then get me some ideas what are the advances that can be done. Right? From your given the knowledge, let me see who can share the depth of the study. Now going back into the story. I took a copper plate, 3 millimeter, and I threw it there. Okay, this absorbed. Within 2 minutes, it got heated up to the temperature I wanted. So what happens with this guy? Whether I like it or not, this guy is not heating the water, right? I put this one into the water, or through the water means again it gets submerged to top inside, right? So I'm trying to hold it this way. This instead of sending the water together, because if I send little water, I know that it can get heated up fast. Okay? If I just put only a stagnating water, I'm just leaving in the channels. I'm just having the channels and put the water there. Of course, the water is sterilized, so it is less, it can heat up. But more than that, if you are sitting in your car, do you feel cold if the wind is down? The window is down, do you feel chill? Not much. But if your car is moving, you are feeling much chill, right? Why? The relative velocity. Velocity is dictating. We saw in our introductory lecture, convection is much, much stronger than your conviction. So I wanted this guy to move instead of sitting there, right? So though it is a liquid, I wanted this guy to move. So faster it moves, faster will be your heat transfer too. So I, instead of putting only in the channels, I'm going to make it like a tube so that I can pump to my liquid, right? Or I use a fan to blow the air. Whatever the working fluid we are going to come in. So this is the idea behind we are going to have a tube and it. So now that I have a tube to be inserted, I go and take the tubes in at the beginning and my copper is getting heated up. From that, it is by conduction, it is connecting to the wall of the tube. Then these tubes also can be either copper, it's good, but if not, it is much below here. Sometimes mostly these are all done by the aluminum. Okay, but quality, yes, it is also can be getting connected much faster. So now some 99% people go for copper as the base. But these days things are, that are the advances we wanted to go and see. But without knowing the functioning of why, you're not going to come up with an idea. We have reached kind of a close to saturation, but still there are MS, PhD students coming up. There is no terminal degree other than PhD. Double PhD, triple PhD can be done. But you need to identify what kind of innovation work I can be doing. And if I'm going to tell the title, this title of this topic was Advances on Your Renewable Energy. Advances can be talked on one lecture, finished. Show the pictures, these are the recent things, finished. That's not the point, it can be extended. You need to know fundamental. You need to become creative. You need to know why, whether you are a buying person or you want to create something. That is why with the angle, we need to give some fundamentals before we can show you these are the recent things that is sitting in the system. You and I are a good weak people. We will be able to get it. We are not the innovators, right? We have done PhD by changing a little bit of calling us an innovation. That's the reason we are going in this depth. So do not think that this workshop, what it was given, is nothing to do with what is recent. If I'm telling recent, you will learn only about that object, that's it, you will leave. You will not get the global perspective. Okay, so look at the thing, what is my take of, what is that? Then you will make every sense of it. That's the reason I'm mentioning this like that. Okay, now I'm having that the velocity can be increased depending on my mass flow rate and things can be. Now I put it there, maybe within an hour, my water can get heated up, but I still have a problem here. What is happening? When it thing goes, it's always a coin with both the sides. Remember that as a philosophical graph in your life. A coin has both the sides. Night, day, everything is happening around you. It's all up to you how we look at it. Then you are studying, you want to lose it as well. Someone is playing around, and then they are also losing as well. Good as the bad. But what type of good you are getting, what type of bad is happening, is the story there. So, in other words, you are educating, you are sacrificing your life after 30 years or 25 years, non-stop from kindergarten to there, to studying, because you want to enjoy a relatively stress-free life, working on the object, not a physical object. Brain is much more expensive power that you can utilize it than your physical, right? Physical, you have to build your body. But unfortunately, you see, that appears to be more hard. I want to tell a story here. My dad had a brother. Brother works in a lab. My dad works in a school, okay? Mother feeds the person, my dad, with a better food, his own brother, the other fellow who works in the field, he gives ragi balls. Ragi is kind of a low profile food, like that's what in those days, but these days, you know, camel back, you are back into ragi. So what I'm telling is that's considered to be enriched food. So the dad asked Ma, why Mom, you're taking brother to be with the low food and with me with the peas and dosas? Then Mom says that brain works, you, when you lie down, when I put a butter on the forehead, butter melts good for you, but not for him. So the brain work, that's why universe also, they try to say that the brain work is much more tough to get it, to understand it, than the physical job. That is why you are paid more than the physical guy who is doing. So we are investing in our education, not only for the passion what we have, also we wanted to have a relatively free life. What I wanted to say is, anything that is happening, the other thing comes along with it, without that life never balances. Even mechanical things also never balances. So now, I had this copper metal, I had this one, it is getting heated up, but at the same point of time, it is having the losses also. Conductivity is a property, it can conduct in heat, it can release the heat as well. Both the jobs is happening. So I want to arrest the negative part. So the negative part can be arrested, it's nothing, no other purpose for it. Just put a box, put some insulation, leave it, it arrests the heat. So you, today we became different types of insulation, innovativeness. Because you knew the need of it, what it is doing. I want to arrest the heat. Arrest the heat, I can put my hands and close it, or I can have a cloth and wind it, or I can put a cotton and wind it. Whatever the objective you have, you know, a cardboard and put it inside, you can trap the heat to certain time. If I wanted to have more trapping, vacuum insulations are there, dispersed insulations are there. The different types of technology is coming up, different types, and then it's also associated with the cost also, right? What I can and what I cannot. So these are the aspects, when I know that the principle, what I want to do, my one principle, one objective is my bucket of water to be heated up for me to take bath. So for that, I'm working on the timing of it, so I'm sitting there. So I'm going back and then closing it, I'm adding a metallic plate, and I'm insulating it. Okay, I'm down at the bottom, it is insulated. Now what is happening to my job? My copper is exposed to my sky. Whether I like it or not, this guy is getting heated. Yes, it is conducting in all different directions. One is to the top, one is to the bottom, one is to the side. Agreed. My side and my bottom is affecting my water inside this to get heated up. But what happens to my top? It is losing still. So I'm putting in a plate there. In your kitchen, you are using a metallic plate. Or you can put a glass plate to see what is the consistency of the cooking going on. Innovation. Earlier was a metallic plate or a wooden plate or a mud plate or blah blah blah. And slowly things came, it became now transparent. But different types of materials of the perfect gas can be there, which can withstand temperatures in the ovens also. You can put it in the ovens, right? And different kinds of written glass plates can withstand the temperature that can be put inside. So again, we had a glass plate. Why we chose a glass plate? We wanted the radiation to pass through without any restriction about my incoming radiation, my transmission. But having said that, it cannot do 100% give away. It has a disease in itself. It will be absorbing some amount of radiation. So this is the story behind how to get my hot water. Why I am covering with a glass plate? Why I have the insulation cover? From this historical box. This historical box was done in the 1700s in some idea. So how many hundreds, I mean, in fact, this kind of thermal power plant, all this was introduced in 1900s itself. Hot water heating in a bucket of water in the copper vessels was done by Chinese 2000 years back. It took at least, I know the knowledge is, it took about minimum a century from 1900s, now we are in the 2000s, right? And it took 1,000 years to talk about renewable energy. All was exposed before. Going back my dears, so what we were talking about is about why we are doing. Minimum is capturing people. Now do your innovations. I had a tube to pass it, go and corrugate it. I had a plate, go and corrugate it, increase it. All that you had, these three equations, Ka, dT by delta T, Ha delta T, and sigma delta T. What is that? Another Q is going back and putting as a Ha delta T. Another Q is your sigma A delta T. Or, for radiation alone, in two different ways you can have two. Or, HR, A delta T. That's all. To get the heat back. Now comes the innovation. Is that it's an application? Now I'm telling you how the collections can be increased and decreased. And so that is where we are introducing our flat plate collector. And then it need not be flat plate, it can be any type. So slowly, flat plate became a tube, right? In a tube shape. Do you guys have in the lab evacuated tubes? You have, right? At least when they happen to see, at least they can go around. So, I was associated with glass, and glass was introduced from Shanghai Geothermal University. I have, from Hong Kong days, I have connections to students come as postdocs. Anyway, some project connections are there with Shanghai. Glass and glass. They don't even want to spend because metal is expensive. Let it reduce it. And then I can compensate that by creating vacuum. Different kind of thing. Take an individual tube, glass, coat that glass with your, because I want to absorb. When I absorb, reflections take place. I want to minimize the reflections. I want to absorb only. So I'm going with a selective coating, nickel chrome or any kind of material. That's another materials research. It's all interdisciplinary. People are doing in different areas, but what I wanted to say is the idea behind this is for my collective. They come with the innovative ideas to do that particular job. How I can minimize the effectiveness. Given this, let us jump into the knowledge of your flat plate collectors. I had a metallic plate. My metallic plate, I wanted to drive my water with some force or with some speed. So I'm having the tube. Now I become greedy. I have one tube. Only one outlet for a given plate. Only one tube. I'm wasting another energy. Here, in this place, my water is, whatever it is heated, immediately it is absorbed by my water. But other things are all getting wasted. Of course it will be flowing when it is heating. That is the temperature gradient. It will be flowing this direction. But at the same time, it is also losing heat. Higher the temperature, higher will be your losses also. Though I am gaining, it is going to lose. So I need to make some kind of an optimal way in order to restrict about this delta T so that this does not get overheated. Whatever the heat I gain, how quickly I can transfer it back to my liquid so that the liquid can be, the tube here, it can be insulated. Once it comes out, it goes inside my home, gets stored there. So how should I do it? My objective is to minimize the temperature of the plate. Means what? Not to get less heated. Get heated more, but utilize it as quickly as possible. That is the idea behind. Now I have one tube. If I put another tube, I can utilize much quicker. But again, I become greedy. Can I put it like this? Every tube, it is actually, that will also cause some problem for you guys because it absorbs so quickly. Not become effective, it will become only a pure convection kind of stuff. So instead of doing that, it requires a certain amount of spacing so that the metallic plate gets absorbed to a certain value so that it can communicate it. So all these values, the spacing between the tube, how thick should be my metallic plate, what should be your material of this type of material which is reflected by K. Only these three parameters can dictate whatever the collector you are going to choose. This is what is your research. It can, only thermal conductivity itself can become research. That is how people have introduced different types. We will be seeing it. I wanted to first give the exercise to you all, and then I will tell you all what are the advances in this fundamental things people have done. That tomorrow's lecture, we will see all the application systems, recent advances and everything. Now going back, my guys, so we understand what it is happening here and why it is in speech. Okay, I built my system. It is sitting outside. But I want to calculate and see before even waiting and checking how much temperature it can reach. So I'm going into my modeling. I wanted to do the model. So in order to model, can I go and see that how much losses is taking place? Can I visually see? No, I can only go and calculate it using this kind of equation. So I'm going back to the box and checking that is, see from here before I show your thermal resistance network. The easiest part, anytime if you wanted to calculate this, going through the resistance method. What is current? What is Ohm's law? What is Ohm's law? I is equals to?
Yeah.
So now we are telling that if the current has to flow, you have the voltage difference by its resistance, right? Similar to your current flow, I can write my heat flow, right? My heat equation is this guy. I'm taking this as a simplest equation. I can come here, but I don't have the enough of mode of erasing and doing it. Let me go on with this simple equation, then show it to you. What is this guy? I wanted my current flow instead of current flow. This is the heat flow, right? And what is the driving force you need? I said that either pressure gradient, voltage gradient, or temperature gradient for any flow to take place, right? So here, before the heat flow, I need the temperature gradient to exist. So keep that guy alone in the numerator. So I will keep that guy alone in the numerator, throw everything else to the denominator. So if I have to dip, throwing into the denominator, but the value should not change, means it has to be 1 by HA, right? So this guy is nothing but your resistance. This is your thermal resistance. Thermal resistance network diagram is the most easiest to calculate any complicated. Now going back, can you tell me what is the resistance? Because I always, my students work, created something, issues when they are doing it. Now, in this one, my through your conduction is again a cube, delta T will be there. So what is my resistance here? That is the problem, and they always get confused with this one, the thickness. The thickness, when you are taking, this is not 1 by T by KA, they always take like that. This one is just an R. So R is nothing but T by E. So for other things, it will be 1 by HA. Sometimes they make it as here also, they get the simple errors. People, students, very commonly people make a mistake. That's always the idea behind how I have to calculate. So now this is a conducting material. So in this particular case, so this is a tube. Then in this tube, you see that these are all at the metallic place. And then how people were initially doing this, the idea was only these, on the connected tube. So what did they do? They did a small little drill, put a wire, and then they just knotted it so that it can keep it intact. But again, you know, losses are taking place. Then they came up with an idea of, let me weld it. Let me weld these tubes so that it is much more intact than the losses. Then after that, why should I even make a tube and then connect it? Let me take two parallel plates like this and then connect, keep this parallel plate and shape it up like a mold, you know, shape it up like a hexagonal shape so that you will have the tubes going this way, you know, like that, and then have the other one going this way. So that what can be passed inside that structure itself automatically to this path, the longitudinal path, you will be able to go to radiate and the water flow can different. That's what I'm telling. That follows the thesis. You go and take your differences of what it is, different combinations of the working fluids and whatever it is that's going to become your current. Now let us tell like about what is actually happening in the system. The good thing is my fluid is getting heated up, agreed, but my losses are taking place. How to quantify the losses? Now I'm going to see that what is that in the top it is losing. from here, my plate is hot, right? Let's say 100 degrees Celsius. Another solid surface is this guy, right? The glass plate. So from here, it is losing in terms of radiation. To the surface, it loses to radiation. At the same time, parallelly, it is multitasking. What is it doing? Convection. My air occupied here also gets heated up. Now, if I don't have, my objective is not this. My objective is water heat. So to minimize that, people try to evacuate it. For a rectangular surface in general, evacuating and holding the evacuation is much, much expensive and tough to maintain. That's why usually you are having the cylindrical shape. Okay, I have a question to think too much of dry subject for the last 15-20 minutes or for 30 minutes we are talking about. Now let me ask you, you have seen the gasoline being transported from place to place, right? What kind of structure they use, geometry they use? Cylinder? Why? Why? Group, I can't hear. One. That's not the problem. But that, at least you have taught little in engineering. That's not the answer. Why is cylindrical? Is cylindrical good or spherical good? Three main geometries man in engineering life. What are they? Plate, cylinder, spherical. That's a anything, a potato. What you can approximate it as? Your potatoes are cylindrical. I want to see your potatoes now. Where do you grow that one? Spherical. That's the main problem with you guys. We need to go where close as possible. Honestly, potato is not to be laughed also. If I wanted to make an industry, an oven, I want to chip up my potatoes, or the potatoes has to be boiled or oven baked, especially in abroad countries. These guys are all oven baked potatoes we have eaten, right? They're so delicious. They have certain types of potatoes. If the heat has to be served, we're all doing what? Why are we studying all this? To get a job? Of course, that's different. This is not the idea which you will be using in your job. You'll be doing something else, contracting jobs or something else. Why? Humanity, which is making your life easier? Which has... Now the point is, why are we doing this, guys? This potatoes and stuff is... There is a reason behind that. Your job is what I can... These are the three geometries, guys. The rest all is other profiles we go back and do. Approximating it into this cylindrical or spherical or this kind of stuff. Now, coming... I lost my connection. I was talking. What was I talking? Yes. Thank you, John. Hereafter, you have to stay here. All others can stay in another hotel. So you stay here so that in time you are in the classroom. Okay, now coming back to the thing. Why cylindrical? What is the use of solar then for you all? You are not going to become engineers with solar. Now tell me this. Why? Why cylindrical? He gave at least some volume ratio for given this, the dimensions, my volume is small. Tell me why. Why gasoline is pumped through there? Okay, forget it. You are using a pipe. You are using water for a pipe. Why not a rectangular shape for the pipe? Why the pipes are not made up of rectangular?
Pressure distribution. Equal distribution of pressure on surface. Equal distribution of the pressure on surface.
Give him a hand. Thank you, John. At least we should show our enthusiasm. He's my pet boy in the class. Now, going back and showing that pressure distribution, Baba. You have done the mechanical analysis. Pressure distribution. Gasoline. You cannot afford to have a leak there. The main problem is in the joints. If you take a rectangular thing, this rectangular section, the most weakest section is in the edges. We cannot afford for that. But whereas for air heating or this thing, people use ducts. That's okay, because here the maximum steam is getting lost. It's okay. But pipe, what is the difference between a pipe and a cylinder? Why do we call it as pipe? That also has a circular cross section, right? Why it is pipe? What is a pipe and a duct? What I wanted to tell is, don't come and sit here with an intention advances back in the brain. We need to understand practically, then you can appreciate any small changes. Don't expect it. Something is going to happen. Nothing has happened. It has taken 1,000 years. I'm going to show the history. 1,000 years. For why we are putting a workshop like this for renewable energy now? Why I'm telling you, it takes time. It takes to go and show the importance of the camel to come back. Now, telling that, why is that cylindrical surfaces? We need to understand the spherical is much more, especially in all medical field, if you wanted to store the heat to maintain that nitrogen is stored, you know, so that all the vaccinations can be stored inside it. Nitrogen is the core, the thing which can maintain it -144 to 145 degrees Celsius. Your other insulins can be maintained. All those are all spherical devices, not a cylindrical also. So that is the reason where I cannot afford the stress point, which can not be existing things that is being used. Now going back to the story, guys, my objective here to stay is not only renewable energy, making some common understandings what it just can go. That's why I stopped. This we will be utilizing for your lifetime. That those are the areas I'm trying to focus myself there. This time, now we are understanding that this metallic plate got heated up. My objective is this guy, and it could be heated, whether I like or not. I was having the radiation that is going to the surface. At the same time, convection inside convection is taking place to my head. Okay, now I came here. Through this, it is a solid. From the inner surface, again it wiggles the heat. So in the terms of the convection radiation, what happens from this surface to this surface? Convection. So okay, I calculate the convection of the glasses, that is also a law. And then from here, again this guy is escaping off to the air, so that is the convection outside. At the same time, radiation is also, because it's a non-zero surface temperature. Now, it is lost by the radiation. But the radiation, one take home was from the last class was, radiation can take place only from a surface to a surface. Where do you calculate that surface? Right. If it is inside room, I will take this ball or that ball or some balls and then you calculate it. But if my solar calculator has to be outside, in outside where do you put? What is the next surface? Perfect. So these are all sincere students. You have understood and solved the solar examples. So, for this guy, who is there to go and measure the temperature? I need the sky temperature. That's what? Did you fly there? Or do you, someone measures the sky temperature and gives you? No. You have the equations in your textbooks itself. Sky temperature, at least the person remembers because he has solved as the T sky. The sky temperature is based on the spin band equation. There is an expression connecting to your ambient temperature. They have a magic number. It's all correlated numbers, you know, they can approximate the curves. Like when that value is added, and then you are getting the temperature. The idea is sky. Okay? So that is how you went and calculated. Is that all it happens? No. Top losses is already taken into account. Now, whether you like it or not, the box is having the sides also. The sides also, the losses taking place. From up there, the side losses can be only in terms of it's the kickback. So it is only, I don't have a box. Okay, the side losses can be only taken care by my convection again. Usually you can ignore. Again, I'm telling, when to ignore, when not to ignore. You need to be justifying it. But generally, strictly speaking, they have to include it. Next is my bottom losses. What is that bottom? My insulation. Okay, I calculated my PV bottom. Water, from water, do I calculate to the air? Do I calculate? From my bottom of my collector, do I calculate? I said here, you all mentioned that. Yes, convection outside, radiation to my stomach for my bottom. My collector is sitting there and outside. Conduction I calculated from the plate to my bottom of plate. Is there any other losses in the bottom?
Yes.
I am thinking, I am only asking these trivial questions is just to make your presence of mind sharp. That's all. Tell.
Yes.
Yes? Well, what are the other losses? Okay. The bottom of the box, what temperature do you expect? Wherever the ambient, that much temperature? Maybe slightly warmer, right? Slightly warmer. The plate was 100, the liquid got heated to 80. From 80, the heat lost to the insulation. Insulation itself, it's not a conducting, less conducting. What is the difference between insulation and a conductor?
Conductivity.
That's all. Thermal conductivity, all are thermal conductivity. These guys are very little bad students. These are more good students. That's all. All of the materials is only based on thermal conductivity you can go in. Now tell me, what happens to the bottom? Jump. What is the losses? He says some losses. Let us understand what are the losses. This guy is sitting. Maybe outside ambient temperature right now is 25. Or maybe this may be 27 or 30 maximum. So you can ignore that little nothing more. What? This is the same system. This is insulation. It's a different type of diagram. This is the plate I'm asking. This is the way bottom of the plate. From my plate, this is the conduction, insulation, bottom insulation I already taken in the picture. Beyond that, I don't care about convection because it is sitting on the ground. There is no other radiation. It is because the temperature is very, very minimal. So I don't do it. Why I don't do, that's the reason. Now I know my collector. Okay? Now I'm going to ask you guys, I'm not how should I evaluate it based on the tubes and temperatures is shown here. A quick reading, I will show that what the way to look at it is. Now that I have this guy and then put a tube here, this plate portion is shown here. Plate portion is shown here. And then we have the plate from this place to this place. We call it like a, you can analyze this kind of a tube because I said that no point of putting the tube so close by. So we need to decide what is the spacing behind it. So in order to analyze it, we are going into our conduction analysis. In our conduction, what we did, my job is to lose heat or gain heat. Both are the same jobs that has to be done. So if I'm going to have this as your plain wall, if this is a plain wall, this wall is hot, I wanted to lose heat much faster or spread heat or transfer. Okay, let me use the word called transfer. Transfer can be positive. So I want to transfer the heat from this 100 degree centigrade to my liquid that is going inside the tube. Now, what is the best way I can do that? So for that, I can, what should be increased in my this things? My delta T should be high. That can increase my heat transfer. But my delta T is set. One is T of the plate is 100 degrees Celsius. My liquid is at 30 degrees Celsius. That is set. Or even if the outside air, it is set. I cannot change much. So this guy is already set. This guy is set. I already chose copper. This guy is set. What other ways you can increase your heat transfer? Is increasing your area. If I wanted to increase my area, different types of profiles I can do. How do I increase my area? I can increase my plate like this. No, given the plate, I want to increase it. So you can go for corrugated or you can connect something. What is that? Extended surfaces. What do you mean by extended surfaces? Fins theory, fin. You would have heard the word called fin. Fish fin. Why is it fish fin? That is the language they brought here. Main body of the fish has some fins. Next time when you eat fish, you will remember. Now, what? So here, do we have human body has a fins? Do we have friends? We may not have like wings, but something else we have. You guys have been exposed to heat exchangers? Yes, right? Now tell me. Now what friends we have? In my body, visually if you see, what do I have? Any extended surfaces. Main body, extended, any extended surfaces are all friends. Okay. Now coming back, I'm connecting my fin. What is the positive aspect? What is the negative aspect? The difference of your extended surfaces, this guy, if you take it, is purely connection. I'm attaching this. So what is happening? I'm having both convection taking place, solid to solid. Convection is taking place, but at the same time, my air that is going around, also convection taking place. Both convection and convection takes place in an extended surface. That is why in your computer, have you seen that sink?
Heat
exchangers with all that thin plates. Why? Is because of this. Yeah, so that you can have your convection resistance because your head is much faster, you can control, so that can happen. But having said that, what is the negative thing? My resistance of your convection increases. I don't want that to happen. Though the convection is happening, my resistance, okay, this is only one. More tubes I have, or more surfaces, like in your typical heat exchanger surface, you have several plates ahead. How many plates? I'm greedy. I'm attaching next. You don't think that will help your heat transfer? No, because it will hamper my flow of my air there. I need my air to flow. If not, there is no convection. It will become convection. If I restrict the air in a box, what happens? It becomes convection. If it is left free, it can flow because it has to flow for the heat to be transferred quicker. So that are the things which you guys have to understand. Going through my extended surfaces, to what extent I can put my extended? I do my research. I go and throw 10 fins, 20 fins. No. You have to go back and calculate at least these two things. What? See, I'm still sitting in the first PowerPoint. What do you think? Whether I should have this or not, you need to make a decision as a consultant. Should I have for the film, for my given object, I need to make a decision. How do you make your decision for your film? That's called as a film effectiveness, right? What is your effectiveness? That guy says that the effectiveness can be equal to what is your heat transfer with the fin? What is your heat transfer without a fin? Go back and calculate your QF. Go for fin heat transfer without a fin. For example, this is the guy. If I don't have the fin, fin is a rectangle, right? This is a rectangular shape. This is it. What is the heat transfer? This is the space it occupied. This is this point of which it occupied, my this thing. What is the heat transfer taken in this space without the fin? What is the heat transfer if it is taking place with the fin? The cross-sectional area of that meter. So this is nothing but H, the cross-sectional area of that glass times of your base, of that is the base temperature you come in. So you can calculate and see when do you use the fins, the more fins? It has to be minimum of, if it is one, effectiveness is one means what? No use. You're doing that. So at least minimum two. Minimum two has to come in order to do that. And again, you will understand that this QF, the efficiency of the film, will be greater only if it is maintained as much as possible the film is at the base temperature. But as long as the base temperature is there, then the value will be much, much lesser. So going with that, you will tell like what is the QF, what is the Q maximum of the film you will get, that is, if it is maintained at your base temperature, you will be able to go and calculate it. Why I wanted is, when you guys do research, when you decide, because even producing a simple film can become a research itself. What type of a profile of the film if you provide, it will become this. Now, I'm starting here to ask a question so that I jump to the next PowerPoint. I want to provide a fin. That fin I wanted to, again, simplest thing this is about having your rectangular cross section. I can have cylindrical cross sections too. I can have any kind of a profile. People generally use a rectangle, more standardized is your rectangle. Okay, but I have a constraint. Solar is another thing. But the same solar, if I want the solar utilized in my satellite, what is my main objective in my satellite, guys? My satellite is unmanned, somewhere sitting. I cannot compromise on the quality. Even if it is expensive, I need to go for something which will be trouble-free, right? So that's why photovoltaics also, we go for crystalline cylinder. Now coming, this all we saw in the introduction. Now coming back and saying that, what type of heat exchanger you will be going? A rectangular profile or a parabolic profile? What kind of profile you will go for? You will choose. Your main idea is for the systems that is used in the satellite, your weight has to be as minimal as possible. That becomes your objective there. So if I can get the surface area as much as possible, but so parabolic profile can give you the same thing, which an extended surface, much expensive, like the blades, turbine blades, we have seen already, turbine blades, thin blades.
The profiling of the blades itself becomes expensive, but still we will be going for that kind of profiles when you are doing it. But for solar work on the earth, this is my sophisticated means, no one will care, should play this. You are telling them, if you tell like this is 2000 rupees for a simple collector like that. The 400 rupees, beyond that, no one will spend anything. So that is the idea behind, and going back into your little bit of heat transfer coverage, which it tries to understand for you guys is, in this particular place when you see here, this point, the point where my liquid heating is there, this guy area, the temperature will be at the base temperature. Once it is come inside, it is your fluid temperature. From base to here, this will be the most minimal point, the maximum point. If you take the spacing center to center as your spacing, the from the base to this acts as your fin. From this, it acts as a fin. So the fin temperature will become the maximum temperature is in the, okay, this is your center of the plate. Okay, this acts as a fin for it, and then in this point will be the maximum point, and then from the maximum point the temperature will drop back to your base because it is absorbing. So naturally temperature profile from the center of the plate, center of the spacing, it will be dropping in the temperature. But my idea of providing the fins and the spacing is controlled by, with a pure objective is my Tmax should be as much as less. So I want to keep the plate temperature as lower as possible, as low as possible. That's all you can do. You can never make it to zero. Then there is no conduction, no heat transfer. So there should be as minimal as possible so that you can attack. How to attack? I'm not going into derivation of the equations and all. I'm just trying to provide you that this fin efficiency, F, it is given by, it is a factor that tries to connect both the spacings, how much spacing I should leave, what type of material I should get, what type of thickness, that's all. These three parameters related we call as a fin efficiency. That one is given by this expression. Using this equation, we can have the hyperbolic function of your tan. You can calculate it S, D, everything is related there. You go substitute, you get the data. But now at least you will have an idea where to. But I wanted to tell, practically when you see guys, this is the most sensitive area where the efficiencies are related. Especially in the profile of this ratio, 1 to 1.5, very, very critical. You can see that the thicker block to that, let us take this guy, a thick copper sheet to your steel sheet, it drops from 0.95 to your 0.9. Ah, it's not much, 5% only. No, every little percentage will reflect in your overall efficiency that much. So that is the idea behind your calculating it. I am not going in this. This all you can go back and see here. It is given the values of your copper around 300 to 400. But main thing I wanted to draw is only that. The other one is your aluminum. These days is very common. It is around 200. But whereas the stainless steel we commonly see in our common life is about that. It is around 60 watts per meter Kelvin. So what material I should use for my story, we can always see that, and I don't want to go and flush it. All that I wanted to come here, guys, is this all we went and saw. I wanted to come, back to let that be there. I still need to take you all to that place. Okay, I have my collector. I know what I have to play around. How should I do it? What is my main job? Is how efficient is that? How efficient is that? How efficient is my teaching? My teaching efficiency is what grade we get, what dimension that. But your teaching, your learning efficiency is tested by what grade you get, right? So something like what is the input, what is the output. So both input output should be good. It's not how do you learn, right? I always say 50-50, everything is 50-50. So now coming back, I chose my collector. How effective it is? Then I need to test its efficiency. Efficiency, simple formula, you know that the efficiency is output by input. Everywhere, understand from basic, that is easier. Output by input. What is your output? Why did I use my my collector? I wanted it to become hot. So what is the useful heat? I got it. So my output is my useful heat that I'm getting it in. But what is that I'm throwing in here? It's my solar radiation that I'm throwing. How much radiation I'm getting per unit meter square you can go, or you can go for the total area also, either in the watts or in the watts per meter square. I'll be able to supply that is your total amount of energy. I will use the same term, GT. Is that the G they use? Yeah, okay. I will use this. They kept the G as yesterday we saw, right? Global radiation, I mean on the tilted plane. So we will have it as your GT as your input radiation I gave. But now how to get my QU is the story. Now in this QU story is why I'm trying to mention that QU is when my tube was here, when my plate, it is like inclined in this position. Well, let me do like this. Okay, it is inclined in this position. I'm trying to see that when the radiation is hitting on this object, whether I like it or not, heat is going to be transferred axial. Heat is going to be transferred even in this direction. Both the ways heat is transferred. How can I choose the value of your TP? What exact value I should choose my value of my TP in my experiments or something. So what is happening? How do you calculate my QU? Well, useful heat, Ka dT by dx, solids, liquids, Ha delta T. Radiation, all through three different methods heat is transferred, right? But is there any other way I can go and calculate useful way? I can go and write my Q useful is nothing but I can write it as what is input minus my losses can give you my effective use, right? What is my input I had? My input I had is my GT that is coming into the picture. Okay, my GT strikes my collector. My GT collect my radiation came and hit here. So that one is my GT, but at the same time, what is that it is reaching?
It has to reach my plate. My plate is the guy which is getting heated up. So it has to come through that. So when it is coming, something gets absorbed by my glass. Well, they don't leave you just coming inside just like that. So they absorb some amount of material, and then this some amount of material is reflected also, right? That can be approximated, because any material is the three properties that are included. What is this? This solid is made up of? How do we distinguish this? Is reflectivity, absorptivity, transmittivity. If transmittivity is more, we call it as a transparent material, like your glass. And if it is solid, then it becomes an opaque, because no transmitter. See, anyway, these three properties are the things that is telling. So the before that plate, it comes, this GT comes to your glass, the tau alpha, this is your transmittance of your glass, and then absorptance of your glass, tries to dictate, telling that how much is the radiation that is coming and striking off your glass plate. Of your copper plate. Now, once I got this guy, what is the losses? My plate got heated up. My losses is taking place. What's the overall loss? Top is also losing up. Bottom it is losing down. Side it is losing now. So the overall losses, let me write it as a UL. Overall losses that is taking place. But it is combined with what? Mainly the losses takes place. What is the dictating parameter of it? Is your temperature difference, right? So delta T, the delta T is from your TP to your ambient temperature is the ratio at which the heat is being transferred, the rate at which it is getting transferred. The UL is a function. In general, in your flat plate collectors, UL is not a very sensitive one. For one single glass, it is around 4, but if it is double glass, for one single glass, it is 8 watt per meter square Kelvin, but if it is single glass, it is 4. In general problem, if not, you can assume, because it is given in the data in the textbook, because you have to quantify everywhere. John, because Sumathy said, so we wrote these values. No, it has to be referenced everywhere. So going back and seeing, now that we put only one plate, can I have two plates, guys? Two glass plates? Have you seen collectors with two glass plates? But at least Kazakhstan, we wanted to get your perspective. In your country, you get snow, right? Yes. Even now also it's snowing, right? Good. Now, going back, do you have only one single glass window, or you have double glass window? Double glass window. Between that window to window, do you think it is air, or it is some other gas material? No. The smart windows are all having argon. Anything low density things, we will have helium, or usually argon filled are smart windows. Because why I'm not asking ours is we generally go for only single windows we don't require. But the double windows are smart energized homes, because we need to have two windows. Worst case, olden days, they just did not have one. They just put two windows together. Now I'm asking, if you are a consultant, would you put in two windows something like this? Or would you like to put two windows something like this? Or something like this? What do you want it to do? This way? This much? In general? This way? This way? Thing is, you wanted to allow the connection to take place. If you are putting too close together, it becomes again a convection. There's no use. Convection always tries to create like an insulation also. Air is a good insulator, but compared to air is also density. If you go into your steam turbine, your ideal gas loss, you will go back and understand that I can't even, only for air and load. Even air is not strictly, only for your low density, helium, argon, and these guys only you can use ideal gas loss. So, going back into the story, this energized thing. Now, I'm using the same principle. If I can put two plates, two glass plates, my losses will be much lesser. But at the same time, this guy absorbs some amount, that guy also will absorb some amount, another third plate also will, same story like your fins. In the entire of your collector is optimizing it. What is the optimum flow rate? What is the optimum this thing? There are people who have already carried out stories. These all is done in 1960s, 1940s. The glass plates and effectiveness and all those kind of stuff. Not something new, but for us to I need to mention you then tomorrow's lecture, the effectiveness, then you need to see that these are all the areas how people have been attacking it. Now going back into seeing that if it is this UL will become 8, optimized is only 2 glass plates, beyond that people don't use it. People have already tested and told that don't go back and do it again and check it. 2 glass plate is sufficient enough, but mostly people use a single glass plate. So this UL value will be around 4 or 8 depending on the number of glass plates. Okay, I got this one. For me to calculate what TP value I can substitute becomes tough. So at least I can put a thermocol near this. I'm losing my language also. I'm trying Malayalam and with everything. Oh no. We can use your, we can measure the temperature at this particular point and then we can, one, but still, all this linear line also the temperature is varying. So what should I minimize? First approximation they did is, instead of a TP, let me change it to the base temperature, at least one data point I will measure. So if I'm going to make a TP from 100, to your base temperature is so low, right? I mean, maybe 80, 70, right? It will be. So if I'm approximating as a lower, I have to counterfeit with some kind of a factor. The factor what the people introduced is, in this is input minus losses. This is taking place over an area. The losses are also is taking place in over an area, Q. Okay, since I changed it to dB, I'm going to introduce a factor which is called as a fin efficiency, F. From this, I was not still happy. How many base temperatures as such? I know that in the linearly, my temperature is varying all through. So how am I going to take place? So for that, what they did is, I'm not happy with this. Let me measure the temperature when I'm attaching with my liquid that is flowing here, inlet temperature, outlet temperature, two temperatures I can take it. So they went back into analysis. I replaced that TB base temperature as your fluid temperature, average fluid temperature. So when I did that one, I introduced something called as a fin efficiency factor. First, initially fin analysis, it became base temperature. When I changed to average fluid temperatures, I went and introduced a factor called as a efficiency factor. The definition of, I'm not getting into that because you can get on all textbooks and you have gone through. But I wanted to say that what is happening when you're approximating it in terms of your factors. So when the efficiency factor tries to tell you that what are the losses that is taking place from your plate to the ambient, from my fluid to the ambient is the resistances in the expression of the equations that is given there. So that is how it is. I'm still not very happy. I need to still measure outside temperature and inside temperature of the tube. Instead of that, let me do only one thing for the inlet temperature of the fluid. So that is what I'm trying to tell, trying to do. My inlet fluid temperature alone will be measured. Inlet temperature alone will be measured, not my outlet temperature. So that can become any other temperature. Inlet is much easier, city water temperature, well temperature, whatever it is. So I wanted to take the final last one is just substituting your inlet temperature. Then my factor becomes a different, it becomes the heat removal factor. The heat removal factor is again having a formula which is again dependent on your efficiency factor with a certain ratios, but I am sure you guys are exposed to that. One little question before I go and touch on the efficiency. What is this value? Because some people do blindly without values what it is. Okay, I'm sorry, this guy is too tiny for you guys, but you know the subject, so you should be able to answer. What is this G? It is already written. Mass velocity. Anytime, this mass velocity, even in heat transfer we will be using, mass velocity means anytime it is mass flow rate,
divide by area of the collector per unit area. Flux, what is the difference between a flux and a heat transfer? That's it. Flux is the name. Mass flux, heat flux, anything. Per meter square, we put it that language, right? That is correct. Same as mass velocity means whenever the mass flow rate is divided by the per unit area of that wherever it passed through. So in there also, there is a very common mistake we can have.
All these rate equations which we saw, cat, hat, rat, connection, convection, hat, rat, it's a HRA delta T, rat equation. All cat, hat, rats are all rate equations.
Now, what is the main difference there? The area is surface area, whereas mass flow rate is cross-sectional, the flow through which, that is another main area people can go wrong.
I wanted to only test you guys with this mass velocity, maybe use just the data what it is given. Now, let's go back to the efficiency. Come on, guys. Okay, now, now, going back into this losses, I'm having this FR, AC, GT, tau alpha, UL, TI minus TA. My, what is my efficiency? QU by GT. So go back and divide by the GT and your AC per unit area if I have, because if I'm going to just divide by GT, then area of how much is the area I got it collected, right? So we will remove per unit area itself we will have. So FR, GT, tau alpha. I wanted my losses, efficiency is equals to QU by GT. So when I go and divide by this guy, by your GT, and then this by your GT, what do you get? FR tau alpha minus FR UL TI minus TA by GT. Now if you go back and plot it, you can see that what is the figure in which it is looking like? Can your efficiency equation in your collector be like this? Or will it be always like this? How will be the efficiency equation? Can it have a curved profile or a straight line profile? The equation clearly shows you. It is your y is equals to mx plus c, a straight line. Your c is given there, m value is given here, and x is your x-axis. So always remember that your efficiency equation in your collector will be always a straight line equation. And another aspect I wanted to draw to you guys is about your delta T, like I mean, at the deeper than that, what it is, the efficiency will always drop as long as the delta T is, I don't have that diagram, I think I deleted it, that one. So the efficiency, as I lower the temperature, my efficiency will be higher. Higher the temperature with respect to time, my efficiency will be lower. Why? You know that, because my losses are taking place. Now, all that I want to summarize here is what we saw. It's the same thing. This is only for your flat plate collector with your liquid heater. We try to go and see. The idea is, when I'm showing you all the advances and you guys are going to do a little bit of your, after you come back from the tea, I'm going to give what kind of advances your brain helps you to think. I will give you the, each group I will give a area for you guys to work out what kind of advances can be done in an absorber plate, on the plate side, on the tubes side, on the glass plate side. So something like that, we will go back and figure it out. But what we saw here is why I'm having a collector because of the diffuse energy, how I can collect it. I need not think in a blind way it has to be a rectangular box. It can be anything. You saw in your EDC collectors, evacuated tube collectors, it is a cylindrical. It can be anything. You're not touching the concentrator. As a non-evacuated tube, I will assign, it's the three people in a group, How many are here? Roughly? 40. 40 is there attendees, but we may not have all 40s here. Maybe at least 30, right? 25. We'll have 5 in a group or 3 in a group?
5.
Yeah, okay. Okay, we will have 5 in a group. We'll have 5 objects. Before you come from the tea area, I will get that one. 15 minutes is that exercise. After that, we'll jump into the concentrator and I want to show you all the video. The story is, he had given a little bit more in a neater writing, but I'm just giving you all the abstract of it. 5 in a group. You can turn around, you can use... that's what you guys chose, right? You wanted to have 6? Okay. But others are all in 5, right? Slightly plus and minus does not make a big deal. But you can feel free to discuss. This is like an interactive class. By the time I will set that video set, all that I wanted you all to list is under each heading. First, you are looking at the collective geometry. All that you are popularly exposed to is a rectangular geometry, like a box. Instead of that, you can have that also. That is a part of it. But how creative you can become, what can be, if I'm going to pick up, you should be able to answer. I will review all this tonight and then tomorrow's class when I'm continuing with the advances, actually what others have done in the literature and as well as the videos. I will try to, when I'm presenting it, I would like to discuss your input also, your creativeness to the extent the basics you have picked up, or some would have been already exposed to solar work before, they can also add it in that. The creativeness always keeps, otherwise the field is already dead. There's no improvement at all. So I'm sure that things can come. When I asked that, how is that this is to be done? This is a common perspective. As I said, I'm here to learn myself as well. So I needed this kind of a heading. The temperature target is so that you are not touching the concentrators. Okay? That's the reason I restricted your temperature from 80 to 150 degrees Celsius. Means what? Usually the temperatures are in the three distinct distinctions we use. One is low temperature application, medium and high temperature. Low temperature applications is less than 80 degrees. Okay, so you can just use your black hose. I'm giving you an example because we run the design projects for the students. Every term paper projects are something like this. You can use for your swimming pool, not copper pipes. You can use just a black hose. You don't have to coat it with the black. Because the swimming pool temperatures need to be only between 20 to 30 degrees, less than 30 degrees. So you don't have to do anything. Just circulate the hot water, that's enough. Even underneath the water, if you put the thing also, it will get heated up slightly higher, it gets absorbed. But usually around the swimming pool. So what I'm telling is, I'm just giving you floating an example. I wanted to learn from you guys. Each one of us are going to learn from each other. This is going to be utilized, useful things, because you have shared your creativeness to others, okay? So all that I wanted is, I'm given keeping this under the view, the temperatures, because without concentrating, you cannot go for 200, 300. My job is to melt a metal, means I'm not going to have. I want to convert a eucalyptus for my volatile substances, like a eucalyptus oil from a eucalyptus leaf. Usually we use that as an example in the concentrators in IIT Madras, we had experiments that way and all. So, tea drying, if I tell, you don't need that kind of temperature, you don't want to burn it, right? That are all specific examples. Right now, your target is between 80 to 150 degrees Celsius. 80 degrees is easily attainable with the flat plate collector, what I presented itself, okay? Now you guys are going with your ideas, what can be done? What kind of geometries you can think about? One is two things you commonly see here now itself. One is on a flat plate collector box kind, and another thing is just a evacuated tube kind. But that can be two, it's already there. Is there anything else I can create? In tube itself can I have? If I say everything, it's all, I've seen. I wanted you all to dig with your brain what you can do. In terms of shape, is there anything you can do? A oval shape? Oh yeah, I'm not going to stop here. Like an X shape, the electric, but what is the purpose?
where, in which application. Think on that, list it, and then you will be able to see. As a group, you can always come back.
One is on the geometry, on the shape, okay? It can be the collector shape itself, okay? How you would like to do. The next one is on the absorber design. Absorber design, so far we saw only as a plate. But you are exposed more commonly for the evacuated tubes also, right?
The tube design. So in this one, should it be a metallic plate? Should it be a glass plate itself can act for it? Or is there a tube kind? Or is it a duct kind? Or what? Like for example, for air heaters. You don't need to have a tube, right? Just two plates is sufficient enough, because air, even if it gets escaped, you are not losing much, right? Through the tube, I don't generally use air. We don't use it because why? It's minimum. You wanted to blow it because you how much air you can stuff it inside, right? I mean, so you needed a bigger area to handle for the given job. You wanted to handle the huge amount of air to be blown inside. So that is the reason we don't use the tubular structure, and moreover, it is expensive. We try to use a bin kind of a structure. Just two places where itself can act. I wanted your creativeness. It can have fence, it can be corrugated, it can be anything. I wanted the ideas from you guys. So for the second thing I wanted is this absorber design. I gave as an example, we used in this morning, just we spent some time telling that it is a copper plate I chose. It can be any material. Go and tell choice of materials. It can be material, this also, material. And then plate. It can be a plate model, tube model, whatever, or it can be two plates put together. I want to see what you learned, what you have in your mind. Doesn't matter. Here, no iPhones. You have your own idea. Put it there. Even if it is already existing, it's fine. You write ETC. I'm fine with it. See how much you know. See what you can create as a group. Okay? That's the idea here. And then the third one is the methods of your heat losses. How can you reduce your heat losses? This morning I just presented about the glass wool, right? I just take the glass wool and stuff it inside, like a cotton kind of stuff. I stuffed it inside for my box. That's more than enough for a flat plate collector to receive a temperature of 80. But if there is something like 150, what kind of a collector you have chosen and what kind of you can do. You can easily attain 150 using your evacuated tube collectors. 120 to 150 is easy. So vacuum if you create. So keeping that are all like a global kind of a bigger picture, you can go back and draw that guy. And then methods to enhance your energy input. Okay, how to increase your energy input? Back to your collector. In what methodology you can increase? If you stuck with your box alone, it will be only that way, okay? Well, how you can increase your surface area to absorb, but at the same time, your losses are there. Is there any other methodology? At least I got one idea back into my mind, but I wanted to see what you guys can come up. Then we will share, it's a group session to be shared, then we will see what we all come up, what creative things can be there. It can be what you learned. It can be your creative right now, what you thought about it, put together, okay?
Right now the target is 15. We will give 15 minutes.
60
minutes. Let me see if you don't ask for lunch. Okay? If it is not for, no. We will take 15 to 20 minutes. By the time you will take us 25 also. I'll set that video up and then we'll get into the, I want to finish all my fundamentals today. I don't want to go for the next day. Next day is only new systems, what all is existing in our ambas. Okay? Take care. Start. If any questions, you can stop and ask me. Meanwhile, I will set this down. Have you noticed this one? Write it now. I want to go and try it. Don't watch the video if you watch. But you can turn your chair and sit also. Feel free, raise your voice, do anything, disturb other guys also. So you can sit as a group also, whatever you feel comfortable.
Over 5,000 years ago, Egyptian pharaohs and their subjects worshipped the sun god they called Ra. The Greeks continued worshipping the sun under the name Helios. And when the Romans took over, they called their god Apollo, the god of light who drove his chariot across the sky. As early as 500 BC, Greek citizens cut down thousands of trees to heat their homes. When the forests were gone, they were forced to seek an alternative home heating method, and they chose the sun. Egyptian obelisks were often over 100 feet high and cast long shadows from the sun. The Greeks improved on this time-measuring concept by building a small, more accurate, sundial. By 500 AD, the Romans were making windows from a primitive form of glass they used to trap the sun's heat. Around that same period of time, the Anasazi Indians of southern Colorado used the direct gain system of south-facing canyon walls. A millennium passed, without significant developments in the field of solar thermal energy, until one day, a Swiss naturalist by the name of Horace de Saussure decided to investigate the heat-trapping abilities of a glazing material. In 1760, he observed that a room covered with glass gets hotter when sunlight passes through it. He determined the effectiveness of trapping heat in this manner with an insulated glass-covered pine box. When exposed to sunlight, Saussure noticed the interior temperature exceeded the boiling temperature of water. He called his invention the hot box. In 1860, Auguste Michaux used the hot box concept to build the first known solar-powered motor. He did this by placing a water-filled iron cauldron inside a glass-enclosed box that he connected to a steam engine. The incoming solar radiation was trapped by the glass enclosure and was able to bring water to a boil. But the low temperature of the boiling water was incapable of producing a practical power output.
We are talking to
In 1885, a French engineer by the name of Charles Tellier continued the work of Michaux and filled a flat plate collector with ammonia instead of water, because ammonia boils at a low temperature, and boiling ammonia can be used to drive a pump. The exhausted ammonia vapor was then condensed and recycled back into the collector. Although Tellier proved the value of his invention, he had no backers. So, he used his invention to develop refrigeration concepts instead. In 1904, Henry E. Willsey continued the work of Tellier and developed the concept of thermal storage. His choice of a vaporizing liquid was sulfur dioxide because of its low boiling point and high specific gravity. The exhausted SO2 gas was then liquefied and pumped back into the collector. In the latter part of the 19th century, a number of people had begun experimenting with mirrors to concentrate the sun's heat on boilers to generate steam and power irrigation pumps. Since irrigation pumps are needed in desert areas, and there's plenty of sunlight in desert areas, solar-powered pumps sounded like a good idea. In 1875, William Adams decided to make use of flat mirrors that were inexpensive and would not tarnish. He arranged the mirrors on the inside of a cone and focused them on a blackened stationary boiler. To follow the sun's movement, the entire assembly could be rotated about a semicircular track. Adams had proved the feasibility of his invention that achieved temperatures in excess of 1200 degrees Fahrenheit and could power a 2.5 horsepower steam engine. 5 years after Adams' invention, in 1880, John Ericsson, a Swedish-born designer, developed a parabolic trough for producing solar power. Ericsson's parabolic trough collector system has become a standard for modern sun-powered plants because of their engineering efficiency and ease of operation. Ericsson is actually best known for having conceived the USS Monitor, the armored ship integral in the US Civil War. In 1895, Aubrey Enos built a huge parabolic dish to boil water and generate steam. Its reflectors span 33 feet in diameter and contain 1,788 individual mirrors. Its boiler, which was about 13 feet in length and a foot wide, held 100 gallons of water. After exposure to the sun, Enos's device boiled water and transferred steam through a flexible pipe to an engine that pumped 1,400 gallons of water per minute from a well onto an arid California landscape. In 1906, Frank Schumann, a dedicated dreamer and hard-headed businessman, decided to build the largest, most cost-effective solar-powered machine ever conceived. He double-insulated his collector and added reflectors and a tracking device to achieve a higher boiling temperature. The extra investment paid off, and his machine was installed just outside Cairo, Egypt in 1912 to power a 55-horsepower irrigation pump. Unfortunately, the beginning was also the end. Archduke Francis Ferdinand was assassinated in the Balkans, igniting the Great War. Sherman's solar irrigation plant was destroyed. The engineers returned to their countries, and Frank Sherman died before the armistice was signed. Solar power plant research continued through the 40s, 50s, and 60s, but it was not until the 1970s oil shortage that the solar industry gained support. A population outraged by the inconvenience of an oil embargo and a high utility rate brought solar energy to the nation's attention. In the last decade, PV panel production has increased 30% per year. Solar pool heaters have become more popular, and solar thermal power plants are providing a viable alternative to coal, oil, and nuclear energy. Individual homeowners are also getting into the act by supplementing their home heating and domestic hot water requirements with renewable energy applications.
It doesn't mean that right away today, it is for some time later. Like when it will show up whatever you are trying to work. And it's nothing new what we are again, I will call that word called advances. Like conventional becoming non-conventional, non-conventional becoming conventional, all it is a relative terms. So all this thought process has happened, it is there, still things are there where you can uniquely look. Today I saw at least 2-3 ideas, uniquely people look. Who is group 6? Group 6? Yeah, and then group 2? So I at least I will share it in a more abstract way, the ideas. I mean, this is what is the creative part, what comes as a new. How newly you think and then what it can come. I mean, so I didn't see the other group listing. I mean, I'm interested in seeing your, because it brings from a different region. You bring us a different idea from there as well. But I will try to summarize this one, and tomorrow morning I will share it with you guys, because tomorrow is the place where we see that advances. And then what is our creative ideas of the advances? Let's go back into our, a little bit to touch upon.
Can you bring new ideas?
My ideas?
No,
you can, anytime. We are here to share ideas. Anytime something, can I share it with the group? This is a big, big service. Definitely. See, he wants to utilize his evening hours not for enjoyment, but he wants to create. Give him a hand. Now, Zar, you have no choice. You are going to come with ideas. Everyone else will be enjoying and you will be thinking about ideas. Now, I'm not joking. We are happy to have. We are very happy to have. Anything it comes. Anything it comes. Okay, let's go back to our, now that we saw, we had this information about temperature, low temperature applications, flat plate collectors, we had left it. But generally, there are the three regions which I was always telling them. Low temperature, medium temperature, high temperature. Who gives the definition? We give the definition. And in general, sometimes some references would have quoted. They define for their project telling that from this temperature to less than 40 degrees, less than 50 degrees as a low temperature applications and till 120. If there are references you quoted, otherwise you will be telling that this is what I treat it as low temperature, this is what I treat it as medium temperature, this is for the high temperature. I concentrated my work in the medium temperature of this range. That is how you introduce your subject and your way of your thesis. Okay. So going back, we saw that till 80 to 120 watt ideas can come from a simple flat plate collector to back into this thing. But I have a swimming pool in my home. What kind of collector you will use for your swimming pool?
Sunshade.
Sunshade? Swimming pool, man. Outside or inside, whatever it is. What kind of heating you will use?
Gas heater.
Gas heater? Yeah. I totally agree with your answer. Because I'm not very clear in my asking to him. Right? I said swimming pool heating. All that is the end temperature should be 20 to 30 degrees. That's all. But I never said that whether my swimming pool was outside or inside. That is very intelligent way of asking. What do you want? If it is inside, I can go for my gas heater. It can go through the heat exchanger, water can be pumped. It can go into your conventional heaters also. Right? So he mentions that it can be a gas heater. And if not, if it is going to be an outdoor pool, say, okay, now I am giving you I am a customer. I am saying that it is an outdoor pool. What kind of absorbers you will be desired. You think about it. Meanwhile, I'll come to the next lecture. Let's go. Now, about the swimming pool, when it is outside, you can think about, depending on your temperature of your region. Again, another thing, what is your ambient temperature? If it is ambient temperature, something like here, you have to cool your water rather than heating your water. You don't do anything. I don't use your collector. But depending on your temperature, like I am in Ooty, that kind of a temperature. I have a small pool built for me myself in my home. Then if I want it, I can use a simple flat plate collector itself to pump in the water. But otherwise, very commonly in United States and all you can commonly see is just the black hose. The hose itself, water hose, which is in the black color. They just allow the water to recycle it by the time. You know, it becomes how hot. Even in your home, if it is in the summer, if go and use your concrete pipes, whether you like it or not, it becomes so hot, the temperature. You don't have to heat at all. It comes burning hot, right? So like that. So you have to see to the location. You can have simple hose as your, my idea to tell here is, not my idea, I've seen things, is simple black hose can. You don't have to coat it also, it can work it out, that idea. But another beautiful thing, what I got the point here from this guy is, yeah, is it inside or outside? Inside it becomes different. Everything you can handle it. Have you come across Solker cooker? Solker, S-O-L-K-E-R. It is Solar Raghunathan. His name is Raghunathan, but he operated when I was in IIT. He had a big industry, Solker, K-E-R, S-O-L-K-E-R. That was an industry. So in Chennai itself, we made a Solker cooker. Usually solar cooker, you just put it at exposed, and then they had the same issues. You have to be in the sun to cook it and then come up. You can prove you can cook, but can you use it? But he made it for the indoors. You're inside the home, you have your solar cooker. The thing, have you been exposed or not exposed at all for that idea? No? We will see it in the tomorrow's advances. So that, like that, what I'm trying to tell, you can come up with your creative ideas. Now, let's come back. We had up till medium temperatures, to some extent, we can attack through your flat plate collectors. Or it can go into your evacuated tube collectors, which is just the next generation of your flat plate collector. So that you can use individualized tube, absorber tubes can be insulated there itself, because most heating is happening in the absorber tube itself, right? It can be individualized there, so that you had a individual tubes attached. People serve as a individual tubes, and you can increase whatever it is, the length or whatever the size you can. So it is very, very flexible for you to increase its length or to have it as a small modular form. So they are modular in nature. You can connect the modules like your PV panels. You can connect it. So like something, that flexibility is there. Now, if I wanted for my high temperature applications, especially in our United States or even in Indian government, we started to spread invest back inside for your solar dish collectors. We have something called as a concentrating, because beyond certain temperatures, I wanted it for, say for example, I want to make a food processing industry where the temperatures, for certain temperatures, I want 300 degrees Celsius for my food to be really heated very well and then get it done. So what should I do for that? Or if I wanted some other industrial applications like metal melting, something like that, what are the applications I can go? Or I want to convert mostly concentrators are used for medium applications is for that concentrated temperature like less than 200, 250 degrees. Or 300 degrees is only for industrial applications up till the temperature range. Beyond the 300 degrees Celsius, you can always think about, minimum should be a 300 degrees Celsius for you to think on the electricity. Thermal to electricity. So, sun is a thermal, right? Agreed. Thermal. Thermal to electrical. Electrical to thermal. People can convert it. I can go through the PV. PV to electrical, will the efficiency be higher? Or thermal to thermal, is the efficiency higher? Or thermal to electrical, efficiency will be higher? Thermal to thermal, efficiency is always higher. Thermal to electrical is also fine. It's because it is coming as a, it's at least from the sun, it is coming as a, for us, it is comes as a photons, right? Like as a waves. So it is giving you a direct electricity. But in your coal also, from thermal to electricity, right? From low temperature to a work high category, the efficiency will be lower. Whether we like or not, efficiency will be lower. But now what are we talking about is, I produce my electricity and I use it for my water heating purpose. Someone is asking a customer, telling that I wanted it for my water heating purposes, or to drive a TV, or to drive the heating in the room. Someone comes with a purpose telling that I want to have a photovoltaic panel for heating my room, or for producing hot water in my room. Will you suggest that idea? No way, because again, thermal to this, so your ideas and things, it's not because a customer is asking, if it does not make sense as an engineer or as a professional, you should educate him rather than accepting to the deed of money, whatever they say. But coming back to the story, there are little philosophical or moral lessons I keep giving then and there. So going back and seeing here, if I wanted the temperatures a certain range, I need to concentrate it. For electrical production especially, from thermal to electrical production, I need to go for at minimum temperature. A minimum temperature is 300 degrees Celsius. From 300 to maximum of 1200, 1600 also is possible to get it from solar if you concentrate it. There are different types of collectors, you guys know. Yes or no? Parabolic, you know, paraboloidal, you know, tower kinds, you know, right? Heliostat tower kind. United States was the first country who introduced this, the tower kind, the experimental unit, which in California, in your Sandia laboratories, those guys only installed that one. Now coming back, you have different temperature. I wanted to test you again, your heat transfer back here. Now, I wanted a 300 degree centigrade. What kind of working fluid you will suggest? For your flat plate collector, you can use liquid, you can use air. Okay, medium temperatures. I can get it. Now, I wanted a temperature for my electricity generation. Minimum is a 300 degrees Celsius. What kind of working fluid you would suggest? Is it water or is it anything else? Okay. Yeah, he mentions that is some kind of synthetic oils, right? That's understandable. Okay, I wanted it for my metallic industry. I wanted to melt the copper for melting purposes. Even the glass is melted, right? Reusable glasses are melted, right? So, for melting purposes, I wanted like 1200s.
Phase changing material,
that is for storage, yes. What kind of working fluid you would like to use? That also 1200s, that phase change one will not. For storage purpose it can, but not as a working fluid to pick the heat and transfer it to the storage. That will not be used. What else? Any idea?
Carbon dioxide.
CO2, it's not temperature dependent, but pressure is the biggest issue it will give. We cannot go for a gaseous substance at all. Next.
Ionic fluids.
What do you mean by that? Any example?
Huh?
Have you heard something called liquid metal? Haven't you heard about liquid metal? Yeah, that's also a good, that's also a good solution. Liquid metals is a very, very popular one, especially if you wanted to go for tower kind, where the heat, the heliostats. We will see all these pictures tomorrow. By the time I roll on my lectures, it will take you all more time. So those mirrors try to focus on one heliostat on one point, and then the working fluid that is coming, this is only a liquid metal can be utilized. Liquid metal can have a temperatures ranging from 700 to up to 1200 temperatures or 1500 also it can withstand. So you should also imagine that, otherwise why not water? It become pressurized, all tubes it will break. Right? So it is only to certain extent you can do. So like that, you need to think about for what we can use for the applications, what type of collectors to use. We now are entering into the concentrating type. The concentrating type, you have exposed, but I'm again putting it into the umbrella, as these are the common types with the parabolic, mirror strip, Fresnel lens. You can either reflect the radiation or you can refract the radiation. But my idea here to ask you guys is, what is by refraction? Have you seen any refractive collectors? Refracting collectors. That is the most popular these days. Research, if you wanted to float your research proposals, Fresnel lens is the most popular one. We as such use the Fresnel lens. Where? You use. Lighthouses, have you heard? Very common. Fresnel lens was introduced for that purpose. Long distance you can attain, you can concentrate the light and then pass it through. Anyway, coming back to that, telling that Fresnel is the Italian scientist's name. Now, that is the only type which is refracting device. Rest all is a reflecting type of devices. Rest all is a reflecting type. You radiation comes, you reflect it onto your absorber and then kick it off. How many of you all know about concentrators? I don't want to get into basics again and again, lose time. You know all concentrators. Anyone who is not knowing concentrators? So, there I can jump, right? I mean, so we can summarize in this group, except this guy, everything else is the reflecting type of the concentrators. Now going back, you understand that each guy, what kind of temperature ranges it can give, what kind of dimensions it can have. Even without going, you should be able to have an idea for a trough type of collector. What should be, if I have to get the parabolic shape, how do I control? If I'm having the sheet of paper, I want to get a parabolic shape. If you do not have a proper parabolic, it is not going to have the focusing, the right focusing on the tube. So roughly you keep in your brain telling that it is a 1:2 ratio. If the width is the one part, then the length part is the length of the thing, it should be twice. So every unit, you have to have at least a minimum of twice of the length part. So that will be for your parabolic collector. It is a line focusing, and have the remembrance or at least recall back that either the collector can be lifted, can be turned, or the absorber tube can be turned so that the radiation is always a focus. The linear focus, especially when you are coming to the focusing collector, the story here is the two things you need to remember. When we had in a flat plate collector, we had the efficiency written, right? The radiation that comes to the plate has to be taken into account of the glass plate, transmittance and the absorptance of your copper plate, right? But here, this is additional things also has to be taken into account, because if you go back and see a simple picture like this, the radiation comes, strikes to the reflector and they get focused. Strikes to the reflector, they get focused to your absorber. But unfortunately, it also depends on the what type of reflecting material you are using. Mirror if you use, yes, it is. It minimizes the imperfections and all, but sometimes for the weight reasons, heaviness, because glasses is definitely heavy material. So in order to come down in terms of the cost, in terms of the manufacturing, all this, people had invented or utilized different ideas for that. Going for the plus, you have to, have you seen the aluminum papers? Even in our creative work in India, we use for aluminum foils for different kind of ornamental things or decorations and things, aluminum foil kind of stuff. People have utilized. That is a minimal thing I can say. But generally, they are pasted to the hard structure, aluminized one. People have gone into the plastic kind also. Germany has introduced, that is the recent one which I can mention. We will see it about its details and all in next class. But they have introduced one thing. For making a dish antenna, which one is the most difficult, parabolic or dish? Dish is the most expensive, and it has to track both the sides. Instead of making a big basket with your mirrors, 1,000, you can focus it to 1,000, 10,000, any number. Instead of one sun, I can get 10,000 suns. Like if you would have gone into exhibition, you know, you would have seen into different mirrors. You have three people seen, four people seen. That many times the radiation is reflected. So that many times one unit can be converted into 10,000 units depending on the ratios. Now coming back to this basket kind, they call it as a dish kind, more popularly called the language as a dish collectors. This guy is the guy is mostly utilized for your power. In IIT Chennai, I forgot that guy's name. He is in the heat transfer lab. He has worked a lot on this dish. If you see the publications on the dish collectors, you know, our Indian government also spent enough of money for your dish type of power collection, electricity generation. In US also, they went into the route. Last 6 years, they went into that route when they introduced for the solar cities, which I was telling you all in the inaugural lecture. But now they have all shifted towards photovoltaic panel for the residential sector. So that is a reason for that too. But now coming back to the story, if I go into this dish collector, this is attaching, sticking each mirror is so tough and laborsome. Okay, even if it one fails, and it is heavy as well. What Germany has done is they have taken a plastic, it's like a balloon kind. You blow it, you get a balloon of the size you wanted. So they have a structure filled it with the aluminized one, and not aluminum, but that polished one, made up of that polythene material. Then that inside, they just inflate it. Inflate, use a pump, inflate it, of course, not with the hand pump in such big dishes. They have an inflator. So you inflate it, then it will become as a balloon, as a basket. So it acts very, very usefully. And those guys are, they have an agreement, like I mean, US government and the German industries, they are the suppliers for this kind of a dish, kind of a the dishes to be provided. They come up with the different designs, which is simple ideas for the dish antenna, because power production, if you think, no other idea you can think of other than the dish antenna. That is what I'm trying to tell. This kind is the idea. If power has to be produced, you have to think only in that angle.
You people have utilized a parabolic, but the area, the amount of area that is required is huge. People have utilized a parabolic also, but you require a huge area. Try to have understanding at least the ballpark of the temperatures that is required for the different type of collectors. That is one thing I would like to say. And second thing I would like to say is about this Prashna. That is something new these days. Not new, I will say, but still in the research, effective in the research, popular in the research, is this the Prashna lens collector. They are very, very less in cost. If I wanted to produce a Prashna lens of this size, it's very easy. The purpose behind that one, the radiation, these grooves help you to make, this is the design aspect of one of my PhD student work. It's about how to give the grooves. Depending on what the amount of grooves, then you will be able to concentrate the radiation because it is refracting through the device. So it will refract on your absorber. The absorber can be only as a point basis or it can be a linear basis. Most commonly people use a linear basis. When I was asking you all with the choice of your absorber plate, this can be extended in that same temperature as your Fresnel lens material itself, but here you are focusing, so you did not go and look into that angle, but I'm trying to tell, as your receiver, I saw one of the plays, I think a group 6, if my memory is correct, it came from the group 6, where the collectors itself V-shaped. Why not we have the V-shape? I believe it's not this way, it is this way, I think so. That is the idea that worked for that group, I believe. So that is also a good idea, it can reflect. And another idea I saw one was the absorber plate. On one end it is a reflective coating and the another end is the absorber. So that is all can fall into place for different type of other concentrators are also there. But it was unique to read about the ideas there. But I always get enjoyed if you get some engineering sense. Again, I want to ask one question. To stop you all to ask here, I will ask one question. Now that we had the Fresnel lens, and I want to have the absorber tube. Now, how can I increase its efficiency? How can I increase my heat transfer? I have a glass tube. So through the glass tube, I'm flowing the liquid. My radiation is refracted here. Okay, how can I increase its efficiency? My heat transfer. Mass flow rate can be increased, right? Higher the flow rate, higher the heat transfer, right? Given this, if I wanted to increase further, how can I do? My mass flow rate, I cannot change my mass flow rate beyond that. My pump is set only to provide that much, 10 meters per second. So, what can I do? How should I increase it? No, the same working fluid, same pump I have. Now, how should I increase it? Multi-pass, one idea. I wanted in only one shot.
The cover to the bed, I mean, half of the portion of the tube. So, already we are focusing from the bed, from top side.
No focusing at all. I'm talking only about fluid mechanics. I have a tube, fluid mechanics. I have a tube, forget about solar, everything. I have a tube. I wanted the working fluid is trying to pass through. I want to increase its efficiency of a
surface roughness.
Okay. And then? Now I won't say, okay man. Your efficiency means you guys are getting several ideas. Let me tell. I wanted to increase mass flow rate, but my pump can do only that much. How can I increase my speed, velocity of my fluid? How do you reduce the diameter?
Number of tubes.
I have only one tube. Given the tube, you're very close. Go ahead. You said they said that. What is it? You have to reduce? Reduce the diameter, he said. How should I reduce the diameter? I can put something inside? What they can put inside?
Baffles.
How do you put the baffle? Baffle means what?
Like,
huh?
Yeah, fin, if I put fins, it's going to restrict, man. Restrict the speed, man. It has to go and get hit with every guy. That cannot be possible. Baffle cannot be possible. Baffle is only an inlet to an outlet you go and control. No, he get idea. So reduce the diameter. How do you reduce the diameter for it to flow?
Thicker tube.
Thicker tube, then my flow itself gets reduced. Given the tube, what do you do? I thought you guys are smart, man. Come here, think here. What else you can do? What is it called? No concentrated fluid mechanics we are talking about. You have a glass tube, right? How was it given the tube, given the pump, I want to increase my velocity. A guy said that reduce its diameter of the flow or the passage of flow. That's what his common sense said. That's true. If I can reduce, what is m dot equal to? What is m dot formula? Ah, that and all we are very good at memorizing. Rho A V. I want to increase my velocity. This was set. I cannot change it. And my area of this one is given, right? But my job is to increase the velocity. My density of the fluid is already told. I need to use water or something like that. Only change is the area. So this guy said that reduce the area, you can get my left hand side up. Agreed. But now how to do it? I'm given this pipe. I want to increase it. So I'll throw the pipe and get another pipe? No. What can I do? Yeah, see what is this written? Plug. Instead of that, you guys utilize the language called baffle and things. The idea came to you all, it's nothing but a plug. You put another wooden plug, insert it inside, the liquid will come, the space of the liquid will be restricted here. Nothing. You have your hose, right? Your water hose. If you wanted your garden watering or some hose, if you wanted to do, what are you trying to do through the nozzle? Restricting it. The water volume is coming, you're restricting it, then I get the velocity. If I get the velocity, it can cross the distance. Right? So much of times of the distance you can go. Distance traveled by time taken. Right? So given that, I can get the distance, the given time. I can go to some extent. I can't go from here to the other guest house to an extent I cannot fit. Given that idea, I'm telling that simple idea. Okay, given this with your lunch, you will be fine. Just give me 2 more minutes. I don't want to cover anything else tomorrow. I will give a better lecture, I promise you guys. Yeah, today, this is all this fundamentals. Okay, one more aspect I wanted to say in your concentrators. When we were calculating your efficiency, we saw that the input energy was only a... whatever the solar radiation that is coming plus the glass plate what it was getting transmitting losses that was taking place. But in the optical, in this guy for your concentrators, apart from that, what radiation it is being reflected to your absorber also matters. So how perfect is my mirror? Reflection of the mirror matters. Like definitely for your glass plate, the reflectivity will be much higher compared to your plastic sheet. That is one aspect. Second thing is, how best the perfection of the dish antenna is. So how much my absorber can absorb only if I'm having the perfect parabolic or a paraboloidal shape, right? If there is an imperfection in the geometry, I'll not be absorbing the entire radiation. It will be escaping away. My absorber was like this, and then things was reflecting. It will escape away. If it has to completely come and reflect it, I need to properly decide that design imperfect, that receptivity, absorptivity, that that aspect also should be taken into, that's called, let's say, interceptive factor. How much radiation has been intercepted on this? Those two factors also you should take into account of calculating. So all put together, transmittivity of the glass of my absorber
transmittivity, absorptivity of my absorber tube, same as my glass plate. Apart from that, reflectivity of my mirror, interceptor, how much radiation, you can use the ray diagram to go back and calculate that. So how much it is the interceptive factor, is that four things put together, we call it as a optical efficiency. Apart from that, I think when I show you all tomorrow the advances, and then with our unique ideas what it has come, we will discuss more on that. That may be a summarized for your solar topic on the thermal side. Then we will get into the PV part. Anything else, guys? Ready to eat?